Guess what, motherfuckers? I've got 3 hours before I have to run a game of Pathfinder. I just had a burrito, and I'm loaded up on energy drinks. As promised, it's time for more Shadouran story time. The previous two threads, in which I introduce the characters of 2D, sociopathic technomancer 4chaner extraordinaire, dervish the orc with rocket feet and arm blades, and dead man the anime character. The three try to get their burgeoning shadow running careers off the ground as Deadman tries to sell their feet right out from under them, and hilarity ensues, in which the team gains a member in the form of Geppetto the serial killing black mage, and loses a member when Deadman gets gunned down in a chain restaurant in the suburbs shortly after attempting to sell his team out again. Also, there are trolls and ghouls and shit. We're picking up after the first act of the GM's modified version of the On the Run module, as the characters are on the hunt for an old school diskette filled with pay data that Mr. Johnson wants. The characters got a hold of the message sent out to Nabo, an orc rap rocker, and are returning to the job after paying off their rent with Dead Man's bounty money. So, the first thing we do after Trout is out of the picture is call up Danny, our fixer. See, Mr. Johnson had given us a job intended for 4 runners, and thus to keep attempting it with 3 would probably not fare well for us even if Trout wasn't a particularly convincing 4th runner. We needed a replacement. Any runner of our talent level would do. We got Tank. Tank was Trout's player's second character. Although he made some mistakes, he was never catastrophically bad to the extent that Trout was, and indeed he atoned for some of his prior missteps after a stern talking to. Tank is why the title of this thread is now Shadouran Storytime, and not Shadouran That Guy Storytime. Because Tank, although he was a little dumb at times, was by no stretch of the imagination that guy. Tank was a troll. Because the GM had built most of his attributes, skills, and wear, he was a very standard LOL troll build, alternating between a combat axe and an LMG depending on the range of engagement. His player handled his qualities, which meant there was a little stupidity there, but they were by no means the train wreck that Trout's qualities were. First and foremost, the player insisted that Tank have a charisma of at least 3, and would not budge on this matter. He had never played an ugly character in his life, and would not budge on it now. Even though he had no charisma-related skills and thus the 25 karma spent on it was basically a glorified Mackey over. Next, his player bought the enemy at max ranks and vendetta qualities. 2D had the same qualities for Evo Biomedical Seattle, but he was also a paranoid motherfucker who alternated between hidey holes and changed out his accessed every few hours. Tank bought these qualities for a prime running team and their fixer, which had some of us groaning, but again, it wasn't so much a terrible choice as a dangerous one. Next, he picked up Big Regret, which raises his notoriety score. It was related to his feud with the rival fixer. Finally, he picked up Dependent. Dependent means that there is an innocent person who relies upon you entirely to survive. In this case, it was his adorable 8-year-old sister, a freckly little girl with pigtails who wanted to grow up to be a lawyer someday. The GM made a point of doing something insufferably adorable every time we visited Tank's place, to remind us that the dependent quality is not to be taken lightly. Point being, the team had a vested interest in keeping Tank safe because otherwise an adorable 8-year-old was toast. Even 2D and Geppetto, who wear hats so black that they qualify as vacuums, had to be considerate about this new piece on the playing field. The fuck is this guy's obsession with being purdy purdy? He watches a lot of anime. For his meester in the A Song of Ice and Fire RPG, he asked me team draw fag to draw a picture of Edward Elric in meester's robes. So, our first encounter with Tank was less than stellar. You see, he lived in a block with the quiet neighborhood and nosy neighbors quality, so it was basically the most white bread human, Christian Burb you can imagine. We marked the step van up with the AR decals of a delivery van and parked on the street corner to pick him up, so that his neighbors wouldn't connect him to running. Imagine our surprise when he came out, in his full heavy combat armor, with his LMG drawn and the safety off, to stroll down the street to the van. Neighbors watering their manicured lawn stared. A mother pushing a baby carriage screamed, with an angry yell of duffel bags you stupid fuck. 2D floored it out of the neighborhood as the siren started sounding. The GM, not wanting to lose a new character in literally the same session that the player had lost the old one, graciously allowed a redo, and the next time around, Tank came out with his equipment in duffel bags. From that point onward, the team store Tank's running gear at 2D's apartment, since Jagalo nutcases don't give a fuck if you come out of your house packing. So, 2D had called up one of his contacts, an encryption specialist within Chaos Engine. to decrypt the message that Nabo had received and see if he could trace the seller. In return, the contact, V1CT1N, whom the GM and I had fluffed like a deviant gone wrong, most of 2D's contacts were based around 4chan boards, and 2D himself was based off of B, wanted the team to acquire a unique porn film from a seller in the Redmond Barrens. The film itself was not hard to acquire from the seller, a skeezy little dwarf who sweated like a pig, but the case was that they still had to determine whether the film was legit or not. The team drew straws, and Geppetto got the short one. Geppetto, being the face, made a convincing argument that, since 2D had gotten the team this side run, really, it was his responsibility to watch the porn flick and make sure it was the right one. 2D confirmed that they had the right film right around the time he was yelling, "Oh shit, what are they doing to that horse?" Pleased with the acquisition, V1CT1N handed 2D an IP node hidden somewhere in the city, operating through a proxy comb link for fear of vengeful technomancy paranoia quality ho. 2D hacked the node. Whatever it was, it had been long stripped of any useful data. It was probably a disposable comb link, sitting in a trash can somewhere. The real fun started when the proxy comb started beeping an alert later that night. 2D logged in to find the icon of a winged fairy sprinkling pixie dust all over the virtual landscape, turning his comb link into fucking Candyland. In game rules terms, the enemy hacker had hacked his comb link and was using the edit program to vandalize the shit out of it. 2D, being a channer, only appreciates Matrix pranks when they are being done by him, and B involve ruining people's lives. So he flipped his shit. His bomb-headed icon streaked into the saccharine fantasy landscape, blowing everything to kingdom come with a series of indiscriminate black hammer attacks. The enemy icon began fluctuating violently, close to de-rezzing. The text feed in his comb link read, "Zipper oh fuck, zipper fuck, zipper chaos engine fuck." The mystery hacker disappeared, presumably taking dump shock, and a vengeful 2D gleefully followed her data trail right back to her comb link. It turned out that the strange vandal was a Hispanic dwarf named Zipper Go Figure, who mostly operated between Seattle and Titanga. 2D did the natural thing that any channel would do, if given internet superpowers and the docs of someone who fucked with him. He decided to ruin her life. "Are you sure that tank's player isn't mildly retarded? Not the joking kind either, but truly deficient in the head. I'm sure, tank's player is a geological science major with, from what I can gather, decent grades. He's a little cocksure and absent-minded, but not actually mentally retarded by any stretch. He does self-diagnose with Asperger's. For what it's worth," 2D, raging like a butt-mad troll in an anime thread possessed, stomped from her horizontal account to her social networking profiles, changing her relationship status to dead and her occupational status to stupid whore. He put lethal feedback data bombs in every appliance she owned. Every profile picture was defaced with his iconography. Every time she logged into anything, she got him walking physically onto her screen, shaking his little digital fists and screaming that, "I'm gonna find you, and when I do, the coroner's just gonna find dust," before kicking digital dirt on her icon, dropping a data bomb, and irreparably destroying whatever comb link or computer she happened to be using. During all this, the team was headed to Titanga, resolved to find the girl and get what information they could out of her before 2D drove her so far underground that they'd need an oil derrick to find her. Eventually, the team triangulated her location to a merchant bar on the outskirts of the tip, sitting with a friend and miserably using said friend's comb link because all of hers had been ruined. The moment that 2D had hacked the interior cameras and caught a glimpse of the girl, he tried to step out of the van, giggling that no one escapes from Anon. Ha 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 gurk. That gurk was Dervish grabbing 2D by the head and pulling him back into the van. Responding to a prior order by Geppetto that 2D wasn't allowed to get his murder on until Geppetto was done getting mission-relevant information, 2D obliged, if only to busy himself hacking the girl's new comb link while hyperventilating excitedly. As Geppetto neared the girl's table, looking very purposeful in his intentions, Zipper hastily texted a mystery number, with a message of, "Fuck, a guy's coming up, think he might be with the 2D guy, if I don't make it, hide the goods." Her comb link responded 2 seconds later with, "If you make it, then I haven't done my job, Zipper, ahahahaha." She reflexively tossed the comb link in the nearest ashtray before it began sparking and burning from the inside. Defeated, she let Geppetto sit down at the table. She briefly fingered a holdout pistol, and then seemed to decide against it. As Geppetto cleared his throat to speak, she finally broke down and started spilling her life story to the mage in a long, blubbering stream. The story was long and convoluted and mostly concerned how ever since she was a little kid she'd loved the Matrix and the feeling of being a part of something, and she always wanted to be as cool and dangerous as those Shadoran hackers and those Chaos Engine guys, and now they were gonna kill her, and she was Saru scared and she didn't want to die and she would take it all back if she could, and she was Saru sorry. 2D, listening in on the conversation, began to feel like something of a heel. Sobering up, he asked Dervish to please let him exit the step van. What followed was a gigantic super awkward apology between a black hat hacker and a script kiddie whose life he had ruined. Eventually, though, with a little guiding by Geppetto, the two hackers began to strike up a rapport, and the whole incident swiftly started becoming something to laugh about. Hey, 2D quipped, it could have been worse. You could have been an elf like Geppetto. Geppetto took the joke in stride. The other elves in the bar didn't. In response to a request of English, please, the elf clarified that he was challenging 2D to a duel. He would magnanimously allow 2D to choose the weapon by which the battle would be fought, so that he might die with honor. 2D gave him pick related. The elf got laughed out of the bar. It was a good day for 2D. Now, I know that you guys are thinking this went in the sex direction. Two rival hackers get over their differences and bone? Well, I'm sorry to disappoint you. 2D already had his dedicated monogamous relationship with an insane orc Jagello in Everett, and he didn't want to give up the physical security offered by that arrangement just yet. Besides, he was kind of fond of his girlfriend. She was fun, in a break your knees during sex kind of way. So, Zipper handed over the comb code of the cellar, a bartender back in Seattle by the name of Kerwin Loomis. That much closer to finishing the job, the team made for Seattle once more, but not before giving Zipper a little dosh to buy a new comb link. Oh wow, I like 2D. He is an evil prick but has some gold in his heart, and he just passed a racial joke that's gonna get him stabbed. I feel I can identify with him. 2D is basically a composite image of my impression of what beatards are like. He's completely out of shape, a gigantic douche, as petty as a friend-zoned 14-year-old, a little bit racist and sexist but less than he pretends he is, and not nearly as badass as he thinks he is, but can kick legitimate butt in a pinch. We went to a runner bar in Tacoma to meet the seller, a kind of grungy, beardy human, accompanied by three bodyguards, two thugs and a street Sam, and a fourth, cloaked somewhere in the alley. The bodyguards' runners were there as insurance, but that didn't mean we had to like the arrangement. In an alley behind the bar with good visibility and firing lines for both sides to discourage violence, Kerwin handed over the disc. Geppetto gestured for 2D to grab it, and 2D was able to verify the goods by the two old friends' label. Everything would have gone down perfectly if not for the sudden clack 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 of suppressed automatic gunfire that filled the alleyway. Kerwin went down in the first round, as did the two closest bodyguards, with three holes in him, chest, head. Military precision. These guys didn't fuck around. Tank took a truly startling amount of bullets in keeping with his role but didn't go down, so they hammered him with a stun spell. Recognizing the spell, Geppetto screamed Marge, at which Dervish spun into action, switching sight modes on his eyes and picking up speed, moving through volleys of gunfire. Luckily, this is Seattle, and Seattle had a propensity to rain, all the time. We got lucky, as the rainfall delineated five men in tack cloaked military armor, equipped for a full assault. What was less lucky was the fact that Geppetto took five rounds to the chest and dropped. 2D's drones and the remaining bodyguards returned fire, turning the alleyway into a war zone. Scanning the low rooftops, Dervish noticed a discrepancy in the air, similar to but without the digital texture of the tack cloaks. Invisibility. He'd found the mage. So, blades out and boosting to top speed, he prepared to follow the Shadoran adage. Geek the mage. Try to imagine, if you will, a WWE wrestling takedown, but the guy doing the takedown is moving at the speed of a motorcycle and has swords for fists. Point being, the mage was paced. 2D launched his much utilized machine sprite. I kept re-registering my services on the little bastard, useful as fuck to disrupt the enemy's tacnut and take out the rival rigger or hacker, if he could. The sprite succeeded, and there was an explosion further down the alleyway. Hello, Gremlins power on a vehicle engine. And the advancing soldiers briefly stopped shooting as they lost tactical coordination. That is, until one of them pointed at 2D and shouted, "Techno!" Sight him. 2D dove into the nearest dumpster, an action which saved his life, as he took only one out of the 15 bullets headed his way. As Dervish boosted in and took down another soldier, judo flipping him at top speed, and 2D's drones poured into the alleyway, the tack team decided to cut its losses. They split, grabbing the body of their fellow, and the shish kebab majors the other soldiers and a drone of their own provided covering fire. Before they disappeared into the rain, Dervish got a clean view of the Horizon logo on the dead mage's ballistic armor. I believe that when I told this story to one of my own Shadowrun players, I described it as Geppetto is roughly resembling a pre-op 50 Cent at this point. With less rapper and more dying, the first contact called was Laughs a Lot, who asked the team why literally all of them were in need of medical attention, albeit Tank and Dervish a little less so than 2D, and 2D considerably less so than Geppetto. The moment the word Horizon came up, he announced, "Oh shit, I don't know you. Fuck you. Prank caller. Prank caller," and hung up. Geppetto, out of his mind on all the painkillers that the team could scavenge from their respective medkits, is gurgling out his own esophagus and asks if there are any other options for doctors off Horizon's radar. 2D grimaced and said, "Well, I know a guy who's kind of a doctor. Does an organ leg count?" 2D was, of course, referring to his Taminus buddy, a ghoul named John. John technically was a doctor, at least before the whole zombie plague thing happened. You see, unlike the rest of the team who had things like morals, standards, and dignity, 2D appreciated the virtue of having a buddy who would eat the bodies of dead people you didn't want lying around. In his off time between jobs, he had been doing his best to be buddy-buddy with John's little ghoul nest, and so John made sure to reciprocate 2D's altruism in kind. With the collected demeanor of a surgeon, John gave the team rudimentary first aid instructions to keep Geppetto alive, and directions to Taminus' largest compound in the Redmond Barrens, an abandoned hospital reinforced with a perimeter wall. He put the compound on alert, and warned the ghouls on guard about their expected guests. 2D checked the local grid link and, as expected, Horizon was moving out in force. SWAT vans and helicopters force. The nice thing about the Barrens, though, is that no corp wants to go there without serious backup, and even then they have to work their way through the border wall. So, the team was mostly without meaningful opposition as the Stefan sped into the Barrens, at least until the High Force Guardian Spirit slammed onto the hood of the truck. The van slowed to a crawl, weighed down by the incredible mass of the Spirit. Geppetto had enough left in him to deliriously burble. Norse tradition, looks like a Viking. Gotta challenge it, fight it in the material. So, in the most metal scene I have ever witnessed in a Shadowrun game before or since, Dervish and Tank got out of the van and challenged a ghost Viking to a fist fight. 2D, being officially incapable of driving or fighting, decides instead to concern himself with how he'll get the paydirt of the disc when no one uses Cyberdex anymore. Much less Cyberdex from the era of disc drives. A quick call to John confirmed that the basement of the hospital still had some of the antique computers, but learning how to use the outdated tech would be another challenge entirely. So, with helicopters and SWAT tanks incoming, and a bloody, brutal Viking fistfight raging literally 2 feet above his head, 2D logged into 4chan to hastily ask the old fags for a crash course on decking. The channers told him to get rid of the Viking on the roof first. Confused, 2D asked them how they knew what he was doing. They responded to him by forwarding him to Horizon News top story, which read, "Terrorists on the lam suspect identified as 2D bomber." With a final punch from blood and ectoplasm stained knuckles, Tank punched the ghost Viking the fuck out, helped a beaten up Dervish back into the van, and then 2D floored it once again. With the sound of helicopters fast on their heels, as they sped into the Taminus compound, armed and armored ghouls manned the walls, and the Horizon forces backed off, not wanting to get into an engagement in an infected zone. John, dressed in his best suit which was a little frayed at the edges, approached the team and gave them the facts. 2D and Dervish could be given hazard suits for their open wounds and would be safe from infection. Tank's wounds had already healed, thanks to his platelet factory Bioware. But Geppetto was a problem. If the ghouls were going to operate on him, he was going to get infected. It was as simple as that. After tense deliberation, Geppetto, who had lost his vision and most muscle control, coughed up blood and snarled, "Do it." Shortly after bringing him into the compound, John had a banshee infect Geppetto. If he was going to be an infected, he would at least be a monster that could pass for metahuman. Geppetto the Black Magician was living up to his reputation, because from this point onward, the only thing he could eat would be souls. Dervish oversaw Geppetto's surgery as insurance, while 2D, escorted by Tank and his drones for fear of the ghouls around him, made his way to the sub-basement and resumed his crash course on decking. The run would have ended there, but it's never quite that easy. There was a loud thud as Tank hit the ground with a half dozen empty syringes in his back. "Type faster. I've never had much interest in Shadowrun, but you've single-handedly changed my mind. Thanks 2D. Good to hear it, dude. It's a weird setting and an overcomplex system, but once you get used to the idiosyncrasies it's a really fun game. 2D turned around to find himself facing his second tack team of the day. This time the soldiers, four of them, were wearing the rubber gloves and white gas masks of an Evo Biomedical Narc squad. Horizon didn't want to waste its own resources going after 2D, but as it turned out, there was already someone out there who wanted him more. 2D's life was saved by an Edge initiative roll. He booked it down the hallway and sprinted through abandoned basement rooms, screaming, "Oh fuck, oh shit, it's Jesus cunt burgers, attack, attack, attack." His drones open up on the Narc squad, including one armed with a grenade launcher, turning the operation into a grueling back and forth firefight. Tanks Bioware, which the TAC team hadn't counted on, quickly flushed the toxin from his system, and he rolled over, armed his machine gun, and joined the drones in the assault on the Evo goons. As ghouls swarmed into the tunnels, alerted by the gunfire, the corp troops decided that this wasn't what they had signed up for, booking it and leaving their dead to be devoured by the ravenous undead. 2D hid behind an overturned gurney, clutching an ancient cyberdeck to his heart. Breathing heavily through his respirator, he fumbled with the disc but eventually managed to insert it. 2D had been listening to the music for about a minute before he registered that the CD was a music album. The genre was angst rock from back in the 2050s, the singer a deep voice crooner. Even 2D thought he'd heard a voice before, and a search confirmed it. This was Jet Black, the most popular rock star of the 2050s, whose career had been cut down in his prime by a terrible accident. Moreover, the songs on this CD weren't listed among published Jet Black tracks. It all clicked with a little more research and some contact plumbing. The troll Johnson was Darius St. George, Jet Black's manager from back in the day. Jet Black had left him a disc of never-before-released tracks, an entire album's worth. The value of the disc was priceless, enough that Darius could buy out Horizon's entire music label, Shangri-La Records, or even launch his own. The team took a vote. 2D wanted to go through with the mission, because the last guy who'd tried to sell it was dead in an alleyway in Tacoma. Tank wanted to keep the CD, sell it, and live like kings forever. Without the clincher of Geppetto, who was currently undergoing open heart surgery, Dervish voted that they finish the mission, because they were runners, damn it. And runners do the job they're paid for. A non-retarded tank is the Shadouran character I've always wanted to play. A bio-dub troll who hits things hard, eats cardboard and is built like a concrete bunker. Trolls are a lot of fun, but they're built only for heavy combat. They don't have much utility. As long as you're okay with being the team's emergency option, that's great, but be aware you won't have as much time to shine. When you do shine, though, holy fuck do you shine. Tank was put in the van, which was remote controlled out to Tacoma as a decoy. Dervish and 2D now needed a ride to downtown. Luckily, the pimped bike could be remote controlled. Donning their helmets, Dervish mounted the flaming golden motorcycle, and 2D held on tight. What ensued was a police chase across the freeways of Seattle, Dervish dodging in and out of traffic to escape Horizon's interceptors. When the two of them hit the nightclub, though, it was over. Horizon called off the dogs. They had won. Tank drove the van, a bit more pockmarked than it was previously, back to Galville, and picked up a wheelchair-bound Geppetto. The Johnson meet saw everyone at least a little worse for wear. 2D had bandages running all up his side, Dervish and Tank were scarred in new and exciting places, and Geppetto was limply clinging to an IV drip. Darius himself had a cast on one arm and a few teeth missing, having run afoul of a Horizon hit squad himself. To explain the situation, Jet Black's ghost, a free spirit, manifested in the middle of the room. For the record, my vote was to not even know what was on the damn thing, but I had other priorities, like not dying. Hey, good to see you, buddy. As it turned out, when he'd been alive, Jet Black was a media shill. When he started spreading out, finding his roots, the Horizon Media Group had organized his horrible and unfortunate demise, so that his legacy and tragedy sales could live on forever. His last act of revenge had been squirreling away his newest tracks, hiding them on a CD intended for Darius, and Darius alone. It should have ended there, but when Horizon began repossessing Jet's things, pillaging his legacy, Darius had to hire Shadowrunners to liberate the CD, tripping off this whole situation. Only one of the runners from that team was still alive, a hacker by the name of Zipper. Horizon was hot on the trail of what they'd lost, and so greater risks had to be taken. He glanced at Geppetto uneasily with that last comment. "We were paid in full, and Jet informed us that he owed us one. for not giving us the full details of what we were going up against. We marked Darius St. George and Jet Blacken as contacts. Funnily enough, we mostly haven't used them until recently, and by recently I mean 2 real-world years of roughly bi-weekly shadowrunning later. In other words, Shadowrun Storytime is a thread series that will be going on for a while. So, for an epilogue before I break for questions and begin setting up for my Pathfinder game. Geppetto met and accidentally fucked, as in he screwed her before he knew who she was, Donia Rowena O'Malley of the Seattle Families. Luckily for him, his strain of the virus is non-communicable by fluid exchange. At her recommendation, he signed on with the Merlins, a subgroup of the Mafia consisting entirely of mages, and said goodbye to his day job and hello to his buttons. Geppetto also died for a few days, and came back with a distinctive albino complexion. A few homeless people started showing up dead in the slums, their life force sucked out of their bodies and their faces contorted in expressions of horror, baffling the cops. Dervish moved in with Geppetto in the suburbs, sick of living in a coffin hotel. Geppetto's white bread humanist sympathizer neighbors did not particularly appreciate Dervish, especially given that for shits and giggles Dervish started pretending to be gay to fuck with them. Looking to improve his skills, Dervish got into contact with Sensei, an old Aztec pit fighter living like a hermit in the barrens, and began training in the art of Sanguayacero, the storied Mexican martial art of brutal prison shankings. He was also attacked by a random human who claimed that he had killed his father, suggesting that Dervish was a bad dude long before he could remember. According to the kid's testimony, he'd been killing for years. 2D bought a wind farm in Snohomish, the farming community north of Seattle. His girlfriend came with him and gentrified very quickly, although she kept her Jagalo lingo and psychotic tendencies. They lived in a tasteful and well-decorated agrarian townhouse, which also happened to host a chaos engine node filled with gore, illegal pornography, black programs, and unsafe BTL softs. Opie is a scholar and a gentleman for keeping up with these. I'm finally gonna get off my fat ass and stop shitting up general threads to update Dykes of London later on tonight. You made me do it, OP. That's great, dude. I don't know what motivated me to start telling the story of this campaign, but it's been going for 2 years, so expect a lot more stories to come. 2D also sent his machine sprite out for something like its 20th service, which rendered it complex enough to start manifesting into a free sprite in his brain, nearly flatlining him. When he woke up in the hospital, the first words he heard were in digital, not meat, space. Dad, in the meantime, the local head of Evo Biomedical was purged for incompetence, involving some sort of situation with a narc squad getting galified. 2D, once he was cogent, contacted the new head and called a truce, and thus his enemy quality started fading. Tank moped around and looked for jobs, when he spotted a car following him home. He did not call the assassin, the technomancer, or the evil dark mage of Black Grim Darkness of Death. He figured it was nothing, so he went home. As a breaching charge leveled his door and he was filled with bullets, we thanked fuck that his adorable sister was still at school. Tank was saved, by which I mean he didn't die. He was just left writhing on the pavement outside his house with a clip's worth of lead in his gut by night air and ultra cops pouring into the neighborhood. But by that point, with the thrum of helicopter wings, the runners were gone. The last thing he saw was a flashbang grenade with the word fucker spray painted across it hitting the ground near his face, before waking up in the hospital. And that's why the enemy quality sucks balls. I'll pick up next time with Shadowrun Storytime Part 4, in which the runners go to work for us.
Thank God they managed to sort Trade out, and Tank's not half as disabled, or at least tries not to be half as much of a dickhead as Trade, or Dead Man, or whatever you want to call him. Either way, 2D, I think he's a pretty good fellow. I really enjoy it. I love he had to go on 4chan and ask for help how to use this old software. I can only imagine the type of responses he got, though, sadly. But no, as I say, I'm very new to the Shadowrun universe, but it's something I'm really enjoying so far, and it's something, it reminds me an awful lot, like, you know that there movie Bright, the one with Will Smith? I watched that one the other day, and I really was feeling it, you know, it's, I don't know, I thought it was a lot of fun. But, no, as I say, I've just been reading what I can online, and, like, you know, whenever I do get the chance, it's something that I really want to, like, seriously get into. But, no, as always, I hope you guys have enjoyed, and as 2D said in the thread, there's so many more of this here, like, you know, right up, spans years. So, as always, I hope you guys enjoy, I'll see you in the next video, and don't forget to click the notification bell to stay up to speed with this story. So, anyway, I'll see you soon.
If you haven't already, check out my Redbubble portfolio. You might just find something you like.
This This is not okay. This needs to stop now. This is cancer. This is so much cancer that I can feel the tumors growing on my back. And it's weighing down heavy on me, and it's not okay. Can you help a nigga out and just stop this? Please?